Hey, welcome everyone to this week's episode of the Amazon Files brought to you by Mommy Income. I am your host, Kristen Ostrander, and we're so excited about today's guest. Today we have the author, and she's just a brilliant lady talking about different things. It is Profit First for e-commerce. She is an author, a speaker, an educator, and phenomenal when it comes to knowing your numbers. And we're going to talk about numbers. We're going to talk about your business and what you can do during these crazy business crisis times. I know some people are really doing well and some people are going through crisis, but everybody needs this opportunity to understand the different stages of what's going on and what you can do to protect your cash flow, protect your profit, and stay in business. So without a further introduction, we're going to bring on Cyndi. Welcome, Cyndi, to the show.
Hi, Kristen. Thank you. So excited to be here with your group today.
I am so excited to have you here and so excited to meet you and talk about all of these amazing things. So I know I didn't give you much of an introduction because I thought you could let everybody know who you are and what it is that you do.
Okay. Well, I'm the founder of a business, an accounting business called Bookskeep. Started that over 6 years ago, and we've grown over the past several years to now there's about 17 of us. Most of them are stay-at-home moms or have some other need for flexibility in their life. In fact, that's why I started the business, was because my daughter had dyslexia. We needed some tutoring for her, and I needed flexibility. So I created this business to do that. So we basically do accounting for e-commerce businesses, and we also train them on how to manage their cash. We love the Profit First method, and therefore I worked with Mike and wrote the book for e-commerce sellers. But I love that you introduced me as an educator, because that to me is the most fun part of what I do, is getting to help people understand their numbers and how to make them work for them so that they get something out of them in their business.
Yeah, I've always been such a numbers person. And, you know, as an educator and as a numbers person, it's so important. I hear people all the time talking about, oh, well, I've got 6 figures in revenue, 7 figures in revenue. Like, revenue doesn't matter. What about profit? What about cash flow? What are you paying yourselves? And so many people do not pay themselves in their businesses. And that just crushes my soul. I'm like, why do you work for free? So I definitely want to dig into some of this and what you've got going on. And yes, I want everybody to know that we're going to be talking about this throughout the show, and you can get this at the end, but I want to give it to you now so that you can do these downloads afterwards. It's mommyincome.com/cashflowtool, and you'll be able to get the tool that Cindy's got for you. It's going to be an amazing thing. She'll talk about it towards the end of the show, but I want you to write that down or remember it now, mommyincome.com/cashflowtool, to get this resource that Cyndi has prepared for you. So without further ado, let's talk about these crazy times that we're going through with the coronavirus, COVID-19, and the impact it's having on all kinds of businesses, but specifically in e-commerce. What are some of the trends that you're seeing currently with this crazy business crisis we're going through?
Well, it's interesting. I'm in a lot of accounting forums, and I'm seeing people say, well, what niche should we be in? What's immune to this? And I'm seeing people say, oh, e-commerce is immune. My e-commerce clients are booming. And I'm like, well, I have over 100 e-commerce clients, and I can tell you some of them are doing well. Some of them are really struggling and trying to figure out what they're going to do different. And some of them are, it's not much change for them. So I think, just like I saw a post the other day that, this time of quarantine is different for all of us. You know, I've got some friends at home with nothing to do. I've got employees at home with kids at home now and from school, and it's more challenging for them. For us as accountants, we're super busy. So it's not the same thing for everybody right now. It's a little bit different depending on, what products you're selling and, what channels you're on, et cetera. So I think it just depends. Depending on what your situation is, it might be a different business situation.
I think the interesting thing about this whole thing is that I've heard in different forums and in groups, and even our own Mommy Income group, of different people who some are struggling a lot with different things that they sell, and then other people cannot keep product on the shelf. So it really does depend. And we talk about, perhaps heading into a recession. You know, there's a lot of talk in the finance world about perhaps heading into a recession and things like that. So regardless of what you're selling or how, everyone is impacted in one way or another when it comes to that. So I know you gave us a graphic I'd like to display here. For our podcast listeners, we encourage you to come to the YouTube channel if you want to see some of the graphics that we're displaying in the slides and things, so you can get a better understanding. But if you're just passively listening and walking your dog, that's okay too. Just pay a little closer attention to what's going on here, because Cyndi's got this great business crisis trend worksheet here that she wants to show, and I want to make sure that everybody sees it.
Yeah, the graphic actually was created by Mike Michalowicz. He wrote the book Profit First, and it's not meant to be a picture of something that's mathematically based. It's more a situation of the trend that goes on after there's some triggering event. And so the way the graph starts is with stage one, where we're in the shock phase. And that shock phase for us in this cycle has been the COVID-19 virus and the impact that it's had on communities and hospitals. And again, it's been different depending on where you live in the country and, or in the world, in fact. But we've had this shock that has caused an economic change in our businesses, in our life. And many times when we have that kind of shock, we go down through the bottom of this curve. We start down into this situation of desperation. And the bottom of this graph would be that the business collapses. And we don't want that to happen. But in this stage where we're desperate, we make decisions sometimes that are not in our business's best interest. And we're just shooting from the hip. We go from this phase of being in shock where we can't really take any action to making big decisions that may not be the right decisions.
And do you have a couple of examples that you've seen when it comes to those types of things, when it comes to the overreaction or the desperation moves and that aren't quite calculated?
I think people that just say, well, I'm just going to shut down. I'm just going to shut down my business and not do anything. I have not seen that with any of my clients. They've all been very proactive, but I think it would be very easy for them to just say, well, Amazon's not allowing any shipments in because I'm non-essential. I'm just going to shut down and I'm going to call it quits. I've heard of some local restaurants that have done that. They're just like, I'm not interested in trying to do drive-through or curbside takeout or anything. I'm just going to shutter until this is over. And, you know, that could be a good situation if you've got a stash of cash, that then you can jump back in. But the reality is, we all know from a marketing perspective that when you're not in people's minds anymore, it's hard to restart that engine. And it does take cash to restart your engine. So those are some examples of people being desperate and just shutting down. Where we like to see people, and I think most people now are starting to move into this bottom of the curve, which is the evaluation stage. And the evaluation stage is where you need to be looking at your data to make the right decisions. And the danger in this stage is that you don't look at data and you take these micro things that might be happening to you and make a series of small decisions that end up with setting your business up for collapse. So that's why we feel like this evaluation stage is really critical, not just to be following your gut, but to be looking at the data so that you understand where the things that you're doing, the true impact that they're having on your business, not just what you think might be happening. And then what we're hoping to see then is we're taking some deliberate action to move our business forward, to be positioned for what always happens, which is a rebound in the economy and then a burst of opportunity where if we're prepared for it, we're prepared for the surge and ready to take advantage of a growing economy again.
That's awesome. You know, I love the phrase there that's called deliberate action, because we all know that this is temporary. We also don't know how long it's going to take to bounce back from these type things. So, you know, when you're in this evaluation stage, let's go back to stage three for just a second. These are where you're going to make those really good calculated decisions. So what are some of the steps that can be taken in this evaluation phase to know that we're going to be headed for that surge and that burst once Amazon opens their doors, or once the, you know, the state home order is lifted and more people can start coming back onto back online?
Well, I think the most important thing that we've been advising our clients to do is to truly understand their cash. And you know, this is true all the time, but it's especially true right now. So if you understand your cash position, then you can understand how long of a buffer you have with your cash. And as you said, we don't know how long this is all going to last. So the idea at this point should be stretch your cash for as long as possible. And there are several things that can help you do that. The government came out with loan funding that some folks have been able to take advantage of. And hopefully there'll be another series of loan funds that will just help stretch your cash. We've advised our clients to look at what they're spending, what can be suspended, what can be delayed, what can be reduced and just cut back during this time. So those kinds of things are the kinds of things that you can be thinking of. And we think that the best thing you can do is develop a plan. This cash flow tool that I shared with you is the way that we work with this and with our clients. And just develop a plan of what money is going to come in and what money is going to go out week by week. And it helps you to see 13 weeks out into the future, which is a quarter. So you can look out for the, you know, the next quarter and see, is there something down the road where you're going to have to make a big inventory payment, or maybe some loan repayment is going to kick in from this government loan or something like that. You can see when the cash is going to start to be short in your business with enough time to start to plan for it. And having a, you know, large businesses do this all the time. They have a cash flow plan. That's how they manage to pay all their bills with all the moving parts that they have. Right now, it's really important for small businesses to have this as well.
Again, I want to remind you guys, mommyincome.com/cashflowplan. You're going to get this plan that Cindy's talking about right now. And it's so important to plan out your money and plan out your cash, especially when you guys are thinking about right now. So we're in April, almost to May. We're almost getting to the point where, especially if you're preparing for Q4, this is all the times where we're ordering inventory ahead of time to be able to stock our shelves for the holiday season. And so although we don't have to pay for that right now, this is part of the cash flow plan, because some people charge upon shipment, some people have dating. This is the best way to be able to plan for, especially if you're kind of in a cash flow predicament, if you will, and some of the things that aren't coming in that you were used to having come in, making sure that you're reaching out to vendors and asking them about these dating opportunities or these opportunities to have net 60 or net 90 day terms. A lot of vendors are going to actually work with you because they want to do business as well. And during this recession time, or this time where we're heading into perhaps a recession, you want to make sure that you're using and taking advantage of all that, but making sure you have the plan to pay it back when it comes in.
Right. And those loans, for example, I've been very careful in cautioning my clients. If you're going to have a payback term that starts in 60 days, will your sales be recovered so that you have the cash flow to make those repayments in 60 days? So you have to look at, you know, even something like a loan that just seems like a lifeline right now, it can turn around and be a rope around your neck in 60 days if you are, if you're not prepared to be able to make those payments back. And the other thing that I think a cash flow plan will do for folks, typically Amazon businesses get their payouts like every 2 weeks. So you've got a big payout that comes, and then you got a week that's kind of quiet, another big payout that comes, and another week that's quiet. And to start to understand that pattern of when the dollars are coming in and when they go out, you can start to align those things. So for example, when we work with clients and they have a big payment coming in, usually in the, you know, the first part of the month, but then they've got payroll that happens throughout the month, we want to try to line those things up so that we don't have weeks when dollars are going out the door and no money coming in. So it'll start to allow you to see those patterns that exist, and you can adjust those patterns to work with your business, as opposed to it always being, you know, we're in week three and we've got this crunch every week three. Well, let's fix that. And you have the power to do that if you can see that that pattern exists.
You know, so you mentioned payroll and things like that. That's one of the things that we've been documenting, because like payroll taxes, and from several different states, as we employ people from several different states, comes out at different times. And it's always this big chunk of something that you have to remember. It comes out a month later than when you expect it to. And so these are the kinds of things, especially if you have things in your account that come out automatically, you want to make sure that you're putting dates, times, whether you keep a calendar, whether you keep a, you know, I suggest keeping up what I consider a financial calendar. Now, I don't know if everybody has those, or it's just something I have on my particular calendar that I make notes of specific bills that are automatically withdrawn so that I'm just not caught off guard and I don't forget. I do my accounting on the same day at the same time of every single month, like no matter what, come hell or high water, I'm doing accounting on that day, just because it is so important to have not only a plan, but have a schedule to not just sweep it under the rug. I know some people are so afraid of bookkeeping or numbers or just even regular bill payment that they just think, oh, I'll handle that some other time. And all of a sudden they open a huge credit card bill or something that they had forgotten about, or their account goes in the negative because there's this one automatic yearly deduction that comes out that doesn't do that. So making yourself a financial calendar is also really important, whether you do a day planner or a paper or on your Google calendar or even a separate one, to let you know, to have reminders of what's coming and going on a regular basis.
Yeah, that's a great point. And a calendar is a great way to do that. The cash flow tool that I'm sharing with you guys is set up by week, by calendar. So you'll be able to see week by week when the money comes in and when it goes out. And it will start to just become routine for you to look at that week and know, okay, this is the week this happens. Do I have funds to cover it?
Yeah. Okay. So when it comes to e-commerce, you know, there's a lot of people that are going to be asking, like, how do I recession proof? There's this big, you know, talk of the town now of recession proofing your business. And it's this big buzzword, but well, I mean, let's be real. We've been in our lifetimes, you know, we all different ages, all different stages, places in different parts of the world have different recessions differently, but we're all going to probably face 2 to 3 recessions in a given lifetime. And we've already been through one. I know in 2008, there was a big recession. I know there was someone I was a little kid and, you know, things like that. But, you know, this is nothing new under the sun when it comes to recession. So how do we protect ourselves during these recession type times? What changes and what can we expect and what can we do with our money specifically?
Well, you know, I've been thinking about that for my business, because I'm just like every business, I'm being affected too. And when I think about it, what's obvious to me is I'm getting emails from clients who are doing profit first that are thanking me, as opposed to emails from clients that are not doing profit first that are panicking. And I'm like, you know, maybe my strategy for recession proofing my business is all my clients need to be on profit first. And the reality is, I think that's true for every business. I think if every business were doing profit first, they would have the cash reserves to be able to weather the storm, because that's what profit first does, is it sets you up to ensure that you've got cash reserves to be able to get through whatever rainy day it is. Because let's face it, in Amazon, it can be, you know, account suspension, or it could be lost inventory. There's a lot of opportunity, as there really is for any business. You know, I live in the middle of the heartland, and tornadoes come through here, you know, every spring, and that could be a severe thing for somebody in a retail business, for example. So having a rainy day fund is good, and the reason that you want that is because what we all need right now is cash to operate with, and Profit First sets you up with that. And so that to me is the learning out of all of this, is that businesses that are prepared are the ones that are not have a huge debt load where they're having to pay debt when their income is disrupted, but they have cash available that they can use to pay whatever operations they need to cover for an interim period of time until things get back up and going.
So for all of those that may be unfamiliar with Profit First, can you explain a little bit of what Profit First is and why it works so well?
Okay. Well, Profit First is simply a cash flow strategy, if you will. And it's very simple to think about it from the standpoint of your grandmother, your mom may have had envelopes that she used to keep up with the rent money or the grocery money or the money for vacation. It's the same idea. Taking the income that you receive and dividing it up into buckets. And we use, in the business world, we use bank accounts. We find that the first thing that everybody needs as an e-commerce seller that has physical products is you got to have that inventory money set aside, because in order to stay in business, we're constantly turning inventory, and you want every dollar that you make, some portion of that needs to be put aside to buy the next round of inventory. So that's the basic structure of it, is to have bank accounts set aside for specific purposes, inventory, a profit account so that you're building up funds for a rainy day and you're using part of that to reward yourself. You want an account to pay yourself so that you've got money in an account to pay yourself a salary, if you will. And then you're left, and of course, taxes, we all know that piece has to be covered. And then the remaining part is our operating expenses. And if you set those dollars aside for those specific purposes, then what's left in that operating expense bucket is what you have to operate the business on. And so often people do it the opposite way. They say, okay, I'm putting all this money aside here in this one checking account, and that's what I'm gonna use to run my business, and I'm gonna use it for everything. It's gonna be for my inventory, it's gonna be for my apps, it's gonna be, you know, to pay myself, whatever. They put it in that one bucket. But when it's put in that one bucket, you can't really look at it and know that some portion of it's designated. You may buy inventory right now that's not going to sell for 6 or 8 months. And so it's hard to designate that particular bucket because there's no rhythm to it, if you will. And so that's what Profit First does. It just gives you a strategy for using these buckets, for how often you touch things, for how you pay yourself, you pay your Profit First, and how you keep your operating expenses in line, because you do take care of all of that other stuff first. And the important strategy, the important thing behind the strategy is the why it works, I think. And that is because of a economic law called Parkinson's law. And we've all experienced Parkinson's law in our lifetime. And Parkinson's law basically says you use what you've got. So I like to illustrate this when I'm speaking and I'm traveling with my little tube of toothpaste, because when I'm at home and I have a big tube of toothpaste, I use a lot more toothpaste on my brush than I am when I'm traveling. I just put a tiny bit out there. And so when something feels like there's a shortage of it, we tend to be much more careful and conservative with our resources. So having these bank accounts set up with different, with money allocated to them based on their need, really creates a shortage in our operating expense account and makes us be more frugal in how we manage our business.
I love how Profit First, you know, tells you to designate these things in different bank accounts. I can't express enough how important that is when it comes to You know, especially people who tend to overspend, or they tend to not even overspend, but just not even look at it. Like, it all goes in the same pool all the time. And, oh, I'll just spend all this. And all of a sudden they realize they spend all of their money on inventory. And then, you know, when that software bill becomes due, or they've got their inventory lab bill that's coming out, or whatever it is that they're using, that all of a sudden they don't have the $59 that's coming out of their account. I think this is so important, because I think it's almost like you said, like that Parkinson's law is that mental mindset that you have, that you think you've got a lot. If you've got $10,000 sitting in your bank account, although you might have set all this money aside and obeyed all your rules about 10 or 15% in taxes and operating costs and your rainy day fund, but if it's all just sitting there in one big chunk, you're not really realizing that, you're not feeling the scarcity of the fact that only $2,000 of that might be for inventory. You don't get to go and make a $10,000 purchase and worry about your taxes later. Because guess what? Uncle Sam doesn't want you to worry about your taxes later. When they want their money, they want their money, and they are not shy about charging you interest when you're 1 second late. So I really love the designation of all of these different accounts that you put money in, and you tell your money where to go. You don't look at your money and go, I wonder what I should do with it. You need to have a plan to be able to say, this amount of money goes here, this amount of money goes here, this amount of money goes there. That's how you can survive in a crazy business type crisis now, when you think, I'll be honest, that the first couple of weeks that this, you know, coronavirus thing happened and Amazon stopped letting people ship in, we were down 95% in business. 95% is a lot of business. And I know some people, it was 100%. If you ran a restaurant, or you were, you know, one of those businesses that literally nobody's, you know, spending money there, you could have lost everything temporarily, but for a time, to where you've got to have a plan to be able to shift into, I can't spend all my tax money that I designated on inventory just because I'm down 95% in my business. So having that funds just in a tax account, I know that, well, my taxes are paid, even if I don't make another dollar in profit, I can't spend that on inventory. So I think people need to really get in the mindset that running a business, you're the boss of your money, and you need to tell it where to go, so that when something like this does happen, or perhaps you get sick. I mean, I know right now you know, this whole global pandemic, but, you know, there are people that have, you know, they've gotten cancer and they've had to come back and get treatments and not able to run their business and for a short time or whatever it may be, and being able to tell someone else what money is designated for what while you're, you know, taking care of yourself or whatever, especially if you're a solopreneur or you've got just a small team of people, knowing your numbers and knowing exactly how to split that up every pay period. Because we know in e-commerce, it's not your typical pay period, right? Your pay period is different. You get paid every 2 weeks, but 1 week you might get $2,000, the next week you might get $6,000, the week from that, you know, it varies. So having these designated, I like to do percentages, because percentages is a lot easier for me to know, because all the money's always fluctuating, sales are fluctuating and things like that. So a percentage is a great way to approach that, because then you know steadily what you can be putting away.
Right. I like percentages too. I think that works for most, like 75% of the time. I think where people can get into trouble with percentages is if they've got a seasonal business, and many of us do, whether it's, you know, golf equipment in the summer, or gardening equipment in the summer, or health equipment in Q1, or gift items in Q4. And what I recommend for folks that have a high season, and most of our clients during their season, their sales can be five times what it would be during a normal period. And at that point in time, I switch them over and say, okay, no, you're not putting five times what you normally get into your operating expenses anymore, because your rent didn't change and your insurance bill didn't change. And so I switch them off of percentages during that time of year, because I think at that point they need to be using that cash. We just set it aside in what we call a drip account, so that it's available for dripping out into the business during the slow times. So if we're wanting to launch a new product and we need funds to launch that product, or if we're going to do a massive upgrade on a computer system, or maybe we just want to hire somebody new, those funds got put away and set aside so that they're available for growth of the business.
So that's an excellent point. And I actually just wrote that down and like starred it, because I thought, you know, that's an excellent point to think about when it comes to using that as growth. So the people that, you know, especially even in e-commerce, a lot of people think, well, you know, there isn't seasons, but let's be real. There is a season. The Q4 on Amazon, especially, I mean, I know most of your listeners are on Amazon and maybe some other platforms, but the reality is Q4 sales are usually 3 to 5 times your normal yearly sales. You're talking October, November, December, and a little bit into January. You've got this influx most of the time. It's just when everybody's coming in, everybody's shopping for whatever holiday they're shopping for. There's many holidays in a row. And so planning ahead for your growth. What we like to do during this time too, with like we said, with the percentages, you know, I operate mostly on a percentage, and then knowing, because I've done this for 11 years, I know what Q4 is. So I try to average it out through the year. But we do the same exact thing that you said, is that we use the influx of that for the growth periods, because we know that we have to invest in new inventory, and we have this growth percentage that we use to, like you said, launch a new product or invest in a new vendor or invest in some new equipment. I mean, these are things that, you know, if you want your business to grow, especially if you're on e-commerce, running on a 15-year-old computer is not exactly efficient for you. So setting funds aside, I think the misconception with a lot of e-commerce sellers, specifically with Amazon, is just the turn and burn mentality. Just buy inventory and sell inventory, buy and sell. People are not necessarily paying themselves, which drives me absolutely crazy. And they're also not, they're just reinvesting 100% of everything that comes in back in. They're not considering taxes. They're not considering growth opportunities. They're not considering hiring people for helping them at the moment. It's just this rush, turn and burn type thing. And it's such a misconception to think that you've got to put all of your money back into your business in order for it to grow.
Yeah. And I hear that all the time from people. I hear them say, well, I don't want to do that because it's not going to allow me to grow. And I will tell you, having worked with both strategies and watched clients with both mentalities, the people that are more strategic about it, that employ a method like profit first, I have seen be far more successful than the people who are doing this turn and burn, or feeling like they're going to borrow their way to have other people's money working for them. I just for so many years, I would hear that and I would think, well, they know something I don't. I can tell you right now what I see is those people are hurting bad because they don't know how they're going to make their payments. The sales are not there for them right now. And they're down 80% and they just don't know how they're going to make their loan payments. And as opposed to the profit first people that I'm working with, who are saying, you know, I've got a couple $100,000 stored away. We can ride this out. It's just, you know, the peace of mind that brings, it's just nothing compared. There's enough to worry about with health and our families and disruption in our world. You don't want to be sitting there worrying about, am I going to lose everything because I can't, my loan's going to be called.
Well, we've gotten this question a ton, and I've said it. I've always been a tough love person, and I'm not sugarcoating anything because I really, really want people to succeed. And I know we both share the heart of that. And sometimes when we want people to succeed, we literally have to tell them the truth, like it or not. And the reality is a lot of people have come to me and say, oh, how do I start a business? I really don't have any money. I'm trying to quit my 9-to-5. It's like, you don't start a business with no money. You get a job and then you save up some money to start a business, even if it's a small amount, because yes, you can do e-commerce, you can do eBay, Amazon, these different things starting small. Absolutely. I started long, long ago with what was in my house. And eventually the first investment I made was $100 worth of books from yard sales. Like, you can start small and it's possible to do that. And I'm a big advocate. I mean, dream big, step small, right? That's the name of my book. But the reality is you have to start somewhere with money, with an investment, and start smart. We don't start with a $3,000 credit card limit. You have no idea what you're doing. And if something like this happened, and say maybe you started your business in January and you bought $3,000 of inventory and you knew, you know, you're selling stuff, and all of a sudden this hits, everything shut down, and now you've got a $3,000 bill to pay. You already said that you were struggling financially and you're trying to get out of this 9-to-5 that you like, and now you've got $3,000 of business debt. What are you going to do? And so we are always always big advocates of starting with cash. Even if you've got $20, I can go to, well, not right now while we're all in lockdown, but I can go to a yard sale or a thrift store and pick up $20 worth of inventory to flip for $100 on any given platform most of the time. So the excuse of not having a lot of investment into a business doesn't need, but you have to start small, and debt is your enemy. Now, there is always in business a proper opportunity that you could use to leverage debt if you are completely disciplined, if you are, you know, one of those people that never pays interest and pay everything on time. But how many of us is that really? Isn't it much easier to just poke away that cash so that if something like this happens, you're saying, hey, I can make it a couple months without having to worry about some big, huge loan that now you're paying mega interest on and you're not able to pay it back. I'm such a huge, huge advocate for running a cash-based business because you just never know when something like this is going to happen.
Right. Yeah. And the, I think we all get into business for different reasons, but most of the time, the reason involves some type of freedom, whether it's time freedom or money freedom, freedom from having a boss or a business situation that we resent, you know. Believe me, debt is not freedom. It is the opposite, and it will create resentment, and you'll end up hating your business, but you're stuck with it because it's yours. You know, you can't issue notice and leave. You've got to work your way through it. So debt just sets up all the wrong motivators for people in their business. I liken it to putting gas on a fire. If you don't have things under control in your business, when you put gas on it, it's going to flare up the areas that are not in control. So if you're not making enough profit margin, for example, and so you take on debt and go out and buy more products that don't generate a good profit margin because you're not paying attention to it. You don't know how to calculate it. Whatever the reason is, if you're not getting a decent profit margin and you go accelerate that, you're just going to auger in quicker instead of doing what you're intending, which is to grow. And so there's a lot of moving parts there that people really need to understand. And once you've got that all dialed in, then debt could be a good leverage tool. But you need to understand how you're going to pay that back and how long it's going to take you to pay that back and whether you're getting competitive interest rates. You know, going out and getting a payday loan I am not seeing very many opportunities on e-commerce platforms to make enough profit margins to afford that level of interest.
For sure. And you know, I had a debate one time with, it was, I call it Facebook fighting, right? Well, there was a back and forth a little bit about a gentleman who was borrowing money. And he said, well, I'm going to start my business and I'm going to use a couple $1,000s from this credit card. And, you know, I believe the interest rate was something like 23% or something like that. And he ended up with his margins being less than what he was paying on his interest. And I thought, if you just do the math and you don't sell through all of that inventory and guarantee that profit that we all know, the prices shift around in Amazon, and what you think might have been a 20% profit is probably going to be more like a 7% profit at the end of the day. So let's just give ourselves a buffer there. I said, okay, you think you're making 7%, but if you don't turn that within the 30 days, then you've got this interest that you're paying 23% on your money. Who's coming out ahead here? And just kind of put the math out there. So these are really, it's about patience. And I know that no one likes to hear that. No one likes to hear slow growth. No one wants to say, oh, I think I'm just going to really chill and take this slow. And I'm not going to, you know, everyone wants fast, fast, fast. The reality is, if you want a long-term sustainable business that you want to keep for years and years and years, slow is the best way to grow. You make smaller mistakes. You make smaller investments that can be become bigger once you have more experience. Smaller is better, you know. And the reason I say that is because if you jump big, you can fail big. If you jump in with a big, huge, oh, I've got this great product, I'm going to spend $50,000 and get these investors and everything else. what, how's that looking right now during COVID-19? So thinking about stepping smaller and looking at the reality of many, many companies over the years. You know, we see Apple, for example, right now in 2020, and we see them as this huge, gigantic, multi-billion dollar corporation. But they started really, really small with one product. Mm-hmm. Long, long ago, yes. But then if you want something that's long-term and sustainable, you need to know that it doesn't happen overnight. It doesn't happen on large interest-bearing credit cards. It happens slow with cash flow and calculated, deliberate decisions.
And what's interesting to me is, yes, you start small and you start slow, but once you get that flywheel moving, you can go fast and go big quickly, not too far down the road. And what I have seen with clients that have done it that way, first of all, they've had peace of mind the whole time. And second of all, they're in a growth position well beyond where the people were that were with loans when you look at it 4 and 5 years down the road. So it's kind of that tortoise and the hare story, you know, who's going to win the race in the long term? And from what I've seen, I really feel like those folks that started small had controlled growth the whole time so that they were learning the right things that they could leverage over time and paid themselves and set aside cash to weather the storms. Because, you know, I talk about in my book, clients that have had suspensions or have been shut down in a whole country and had to destroy all their inventory in that country, but yet they were experimenting at a small enough level that didn't shut them down. And in the end, they're sitting there with fairly large bank accounts, looking at ways to invest in things outside of Amazon. So they've got a little bit of insurance, you know, looking for business opportunities that gets them a little bit of diversity and divestiture in the way they're handling their money. So it's not small forever. It's small to start. And then you're able to leverage it and really grow.
And you know, the greatest part about that is, you know, I'm an advocate for small action, but small action consistently equals that bigger boom. Yeah. And so, you know, just constantly adding upon that. So, you know, take the small amount, because a lot of people look like pennies in a jar, right? Like, I mean, I've got a jar that I keep all of my change in all the time. Anytime I go places and I pay with cash, which I pay with cash a lot because I'm just a cash person. I like to hold it, smell it, see it, touch it, know it, that it's real. And I have I use a debit card and credit cards for rewards and things like that. Like we all do because it's convenient, right? But at the same time, I still love to hold and touch real cash. And I've got this change jar. Every time I break a dollar bill, and it all goes in the bottom of the purse. Every day at the bottom of the purse, I grab the handful of change and put it in a jar. It's this visual connection to, is that saving a ton? Not really. But then at the end of, you know, when the jar gets full, depending on, you know, coming and going, sometimes it's 3 months, sometimes it's 6, all of a sudden you've got this big, huge jar full of change that you never missed. And the same thing can be for your business and your business savings. A lot of people think, well, you know, $25 a week to put into a bank account is not going to add up very fast. It's going to take me 2 or 3 years to build up operating expenses, blah, blah, blah. But you know what? In times like this, wouldn't that be nice to even have $1,000 sitting there or $500 that you could maybe, that could get you through a month if you needed to. You just don't know. And so being disciplined, even if it's $5 a week, $25 a week, whatever that is, it will add up over time, especially if you don't touch it and you look at it like we, you know, talking about the profit first and keeping designated funds in different accounts so that you know this is the emergency savings fund. We don't touch this unless it's an emergency. And so I think that really, really works and helps people build over time, because I think when you have when you tell your money where to go, then there's no mystery about how much to spend on inventory. Do you have money for your taxes? If, you know, this computer dies or this collapses or that this or that, that you actually have funds for that. I feel like that peace of mind that you have gives you the ability, your mind, the ability to make better decisions, because you don't have this fear-driven decision-making. You're not sitting here going, well, if I spend this money on this and maybe I don't have it for this, if you just know that you're going to be okay for a few months, you can make better business decisions overall rather than panicking and worrying about the fact that you don't know how you're going to pay your bills.
Yeah, that desperation part of the curve. You just avoided all of that because you don't have to be in desperate mode. Yeah, your business may be going through some challenges, but you don't have to be desperate about it. And so I think that's a good point. And I think, you know, you were talking earlier about people wanting to start a business. And one of the things that I see over and over again is that they save up enough money to make their first inventory purchase, but they don't think about the fact that their second inventory purchase to replenish is going to hit before they get all the cash out of their first one. And so they immediately are, they saved up enough capital to get started, but in, you know, 30 days or 60 days, they're having to put inventory purchases on a credit card, and it starts that cycle. So just from the very beginning, save up enough money to really fund what you're going to do and have thought through that cash flow, when it's going to come in and what the timing is, so that you've got enough money to really launch appropriately. Because I see people underfunded all the time getting started.
Well, and you mentioned that cycle, you know, that's always the hardest part, is that, you know, an expectation. So starting and getting into a business and not having the expectations of things that come up and things that are going to go through. Like a lot of people have these expectations, I'm going to go buy all of this inventory, and then by the time I get paid again next from Amazon or from wherever, that all of that money is going to be turned over. I'm going to have X amount of profit and I'm going to put that back in the business and I don't have to buy credit cards. The reality is, how often do we actually sell every piece of inventory we purchase within a 30-day amount and at the exact projected profit that we wanted? Slim to none. Let's just call it what it is. And so planning ahead for that, I think a lot of people, especially in the Amazon world, they send stuff into FBA, then they have to wait for it to be checked in, then wait for it to go on sale, then wait for their payment, then wait. But there's so many things. If you're an action taker and you just want to do business and you want to grow, there are plenty of things to do in the interim that don't require spending money that can actually grow your business. You can make sure all your listings are optimized. You can make sure that you're looking and doing research so that you know the moment that you have cash in your bank, you know what you're going to buy with those inventory dollars. You can scrutinize your numbers to make sure you're making the profit that you want to do. There's all kinds of things to do to wait for cash. It doesn't always mean spend.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
So Cyndi, can you tell people how they can get started with learning a little bit more about you and the Profit First methods in your book and all that kind of stuff?
Sure. We have a website, bookskeep.com, and we write a blog every week. So we're always talking about money topics there. That's a great place to go. Of course, my book is out on Amazon and Audible. And so I'd love for people to check that out and let me know what they learn from it. I love interacting with readers, that they tell me what they're going to do with their profit checks and where they're struggling. And it's really good to hear from people and how they're moving forward. So those are probably the two best ways.
Awesome. Her book is called Profit First for E-commerce. Found on Amazon and Audible, all the different places. Make sure that you grab a copy of this book. It's so important. And bookskeep.com is where you can find Cyndi, and they do accounting for e-commerce businesses and small businesses. Is that the services you provide?
That's right. Yeah. We for small businesses, we like to help them get set up so that they can get started on their own. But for larger businesses who've grown to the point where they want to hand that off, we do full service accounting for those folks.
Awesome. So if you're a do-it-yourselfer, they can help you get started and set up so that you kind of know what to do and you can be off on your own, or they have full services. If you say, I don't want to deal with numbers, I don't want to deal with accounting, just let somebody else handle it. So all kinds of different services. Well, Cyndi, thank you so much for taking the time. I know you could be anywhere else doing anything else. So I appreciate your time spent here. And again, you guys, check out bookskeep.com, check out mommyincome.com/cashflowtool. That's the tool about planning for for your cash flow that we talked about at the beginning of the show. And also, don't forget, if you have questions for any of us, you have questions for me, you have questions about Amazon, or even questions for Cyndi, you can come to our Facebook group, mommyincome.com/join us. You need a code word. Profit first is the code word we're going to use, just that was easy. And bring your code word, bring your questions. We'd love to have you as part of the Facebook group to get in touch with the community. Knowing your numbers is so important, especially during these times. Don't keep your head in the sand. There's resources, tools, and help available for you. Cyndi, thank you so much again for coming on the show. I really appreciate your expertise, and I look forward to connecting with you soon.
Okay, thank you for having me, Kristen. I've enjoyed it.
Thank you. Thanks, y'all, for coming, and join us at the same time, same place next week on the Amazon Files.